Welcome to the Adda 24/7. We are in the Achiever series for RBWM. Here we are covering all the important theory, numericals, objective questions, case studies. So follow the video till the end. Also follow the complete series available in the playlist on Officers Adda 24/7. Okay? Click on the bell icon. Subscribe to the channel. Share it with your friends. Share it on all your social media platforms. So let's start. Among the below mentioned statements, which of the following are not correctly matched? Not correctly. So understand the question. Whether you want a true or false, that's important. So here you want false. First, keep it in your mind what you have to do. True or false. So you want a false one. Okay. The first stage of product life cycle is known as intro. Introduction. The final stage of product life cycle is known as decline. Predominantly horizontally organized model is mostly product oriented with a common customer database information for some of the products. The design for designing retail banking products and services, customers can broadly group together based on their need pyramids, and this is false. Now look at true and false also. So introduction, first stage. Last stage, decline. Predominantly horizontally, that is false. Okay. And this designing retail by products and services, so they can be grouped as per the need pyramid, false. So which of them is not correct? Okay. So the first stage is introduction. Let's see one by one. This is introduction. What is the PLC product life cycle? It's like this, right? This is your PLC product life cycle. This is introduction. This is growth, okay. This is maturity, and last one is decline, okay. So first two are correct. Look at this, introduction, done. So this is true. The final stage is decline. See this decline over here. This is true. So both are true. Now these two only. Predominantly horizontally organized model is mostly product oriented with common customer information for some products, some, okay. So remember this, predominantly horizontally organized means some data is shared among all the products, and product oriented means the data is shared within the same product but not within other products. So this is true. This answer is true, but what is given? It's given as false. So this is not correctly matched. So this is your answer. See, it is not correctly matched. Okay. The important part over here is, look at this. In this PH, there are basically four models. One is horizontal model, second is vertical model, third is PH, predominantly horizontal model, and third PV, predominantly vertical model. Okay. So under PH, some data is shared, some. Under PV, most of the data is shared. Under vertical, complete data is shared. So that is the best model. Vertical model is one of the best models. And what about this last one? For designing retail banking products and services, customers can be grouped together based on their pyramids, on their need pyramids, right? So for designing retail banking products and services, customers can be grouped based on their need pyramids. So which of them is not correctly matched? This should be true. Okay, this is true. They are matched on this or based on their need pyramid. So that is also true. So the answer will be D also. So E option should be there. Both C and D. Okay. So both will be correct over here. So C and D. D is also correct. In exam, if they give you, they'll give you these both the options. C and D, and some option will be there. Both. Because what is the need pyramid? Need pyramid means that refers to the Maslow's hierarchy, physiological, safety, social. I've taken this many times, isn't it? Esteem, and last one is that actualization. So they are grouped, customers are grouped as per this, groups, okay? Need pyramids or physiological levels. Got it? Among the below given statements, which of the following is not correct? in context to the impact of deregulation and Regal-Neal Act of 1994, Graham-Leach Lilly Act of 1999. Very difficult. I don't think so. This will be asked to you in question, but in exam. But then also, you want false one. Okay. I don't think this way such questions are asked, because I have not seen many questions like this. But even, let's see. If your luck is hard, you can be asked anything. Okay. Basically, this is not related to our country. This is related to US. Okay. So what is that? Let's read the options. It allowed banks to branch and merge across the state lines. It contributed banks consolidation that focused on reducing cost to boost profits. The Regal-Neal Act of 1994 allowed branches to distribute insurance and securities products. Declining number of banks and rising number of branches have resulted in greater consolidation of branches and deposits in the nation's larger banks. So which of them is false you wanted? False. Sure, don't think that much on this. I'll just give the answer. If such question comes, remember, it is answer is C. This is false. Remaining all are true. Remember, they are not related to our country, Bharat. They are related to USA. So some typical point is mentioned in the book regarding this. But generally, they are not asking this. But if your luck is hard, you will be asked. So in that case, what do? You first study all the true ones also. This is true. This is true. So it allowed banks to merge and banks to branch and merge. Branch means increase the branches or reduce the branches. It contributed to the bank consolidation that focused on reducing cost to boost profits. And last one, true, is this declining number. The declining number of banks and rising number of branches have resulted in greater consolidation of branches and deposits in the nation's larger banks. Okay. So these are all true, and you want a false one. So false one is given, but you also read the true ones. Okay. Among the below given statements, which are the following reasons responsible for emergence of retail banking business in India? Emergence. Okay, so now you want true ones. Which of them are true? Socioeconomic fundamentals, growing urban population, higher disposable incomes, and all of the above. Quite obvious, isn't it? Answer is quite obvious over here. The answer is correct. D. All of the above. Here, strong economic fundamentals, growing urban population, higher disposable income, rise in young population, right? Rise in mass affluent space. Mass affluent means those who are having this middle income, but are in large numbers. Emergence of new customer segments, explosion of service economy in our country. Opportunities across geographies and customer segments. Now, see, the important part about this, across geographies means, earlier banking and money was concentrated in the city areas. Now it has reached to the village areas also. So across geographies, huge untapped potential for retail banking because of the Jan Dhan account. All the bank accounts, all of them have come under the banking finance schemes now or inclusion now. Okay. In India, whereas till recently, retail banking was confined to this top and middle level customers, right? As I told, in the city. Nowadays, things have changed. Nowadays, it has gone to the village level also. NBFCs are working very hard nowadays with respect to the banks. They focus on the bottom of the pyramid, lower level. They always focus. Because of this, what happened? Because of this NBFC, the best thing is the Saukari system. Even in today villages, Saukari system is there. Even in today, even why in villages, even cities, it's there. So this Jan Dhan account system or Jan Dhan loan scheme, that Mudra loan, everything, those were truly game changing. They have almost removed the Saukari system, almost, and they are still to grow. They still will be growing a lot. Okay. So, coming back, All of the above is the answer for emergence of retail banking. Now, retail banking does not only include accounts. Many of us feel that retail banking means CASA, Jandan accounts. No. It also relates to loans. It also relates to insurance. Retail, smaller insurance. Anything which affects the common person living in the downtrodden region will be called as the retail banking. Okay? Among the following, in which of the following stages there is more growth and sales volume peak? More growth, sales volume will peak. Introduction, growth, maturity and saturation. This is a decline stage. Decline. Okay, these are the four stages actually. Decline. So PLC, as I showed you just now on the first question, this is a PLC, right? Here what happens, now look at this. This is a sales graph. This is sales versus this is time. Okay, sales versus time. Here sales is almost zero in introduction phase. In growth it goes on increasing, and in maturity it's a maximum maturity, and decline it goes down. Now if you are a business owner, what will you try to do? Where should your company be? Type in the comment section. If you are the business owner, where should your company be? It should be in the introduction phase, growth phase, maturity phase or decline phase as the owner of the company. Many of you are typing, you should be in the growth phase. This phase you are typing, but this answer is wrong. You should not be in the growth phase. You should be in this maturity phase. Why? Because you want the maximum sales. Where is the maximum sales? Maximum sales is in the maturity phase. So you try to keep your company in the maturity phase. When your product matures, remember, it is sure to go on the declining stage. So what do? You add additional features to this product and new PLC starts. Always remember, new features are added. Alto with the changed features. Alto car, right? It went down. Maruti. Maruti is very good in this maturity phase dealing. They always add new features and increase the life cycle of that product. Got it? So sales volume peak is maturity phase. Okay, if you look at the profit graph for this will be like this. Okay, profit graph will be like this. It will go down first, then it will go start growing over here, and then it will grow like this, and then like this. So profit will be first negative and sales will start from zero. That is the difference. Okay, move on. Among the following, in which of the given stages the product becomes less attractive for the consumers due to various reasons and results in drop in the sales volume? Introduction, growth, maturity and decline. Now you know this answer is right, decline phase. So what should you do? This is a stage, this is your decline phase, right? So here you should adding the features, new features to this product, so that it doesn't go in this decline stage, it moves up from here. We have always, should always try to remove this decline phase from our product life cycle. Every owner will try to remove this phase. Every owner will try to stop over here or move out from this with new features. Which product has gone into this decline phase? Do you know? Nokia phones. Nokia, right? Nokia phones. Nokia phones were once at this level, peak level, right? Every phone in our country was Nokia. Every phone, almost. Today, where is Nokia? Gone. Decline. Why? They didn't look at these features, new features coming in. When Nokia was there, Android phones were just coming up at that time, right? 2005 to 2008, Android was coming up. They didn't look into it. They carried on with their own operating system and gone. Same thing happens with banks also. Many banks, they don't look into what is the present situation and what does the customer want. Nowadays in banking, customer doesn't want to come to the branch, at least the HNI customer, those who give you the maximum business. They don't want to come to the branch. They want to deal through that internet banking, app banking, phone banking, everything. So that should be made more easy vis-a-vis coming to the branches, isn't it? Of course, personal touch is required, but personal touch is required only, you can do the personal touch only if your other customers are transferred to the alternate channels. Otherwise, you just waste your time giving that savings balance, current balance, printing, passbook printing, all these things. Okay, got it? Next one. Among the following, which of the following account includes value additions like internet banking, mobile banking, tagged insurance cover, personal accident cover, sweep in, sweep out facility, other concessions like free remittances, savings, current, term and combination deposits? Which of them will include? What is a combination deposit? Combination deposit is a deposit of, it's called a sweep in, sweep out. Okay? Combination of term and the savings. Term and OD actually, not savings, term and OD. Right? So which account will have, among these options, which account will have the value additions like internet banking, mobile banking? You can definitely see this, isn't it? Internet, mobile. I'll add one more option to this. Now let's see. Okay, I'll add one more option. That option is, hold on. Yeah, I'll add one more option. That option is E. That E option is all of the above. So if I add all of the above option over here, then the answer will be right one. Because it will be all of the above over here. See, always remember, I can add these features, internet banking, mobile banking, insurance cover, personal accident cover, sweep in, sweep out, other concessions, free remittance. I can add it to any of the account, whatever I want. I can add it to savings, current, term, combination. You'll say, how can I add it to term deposit? Yeah, I can add it. Internet banking can be there for FD also. Mobile banking, I can give it for FD also. Am I not a customer of the bank? Any term deposit customer who's having only FD with you is also the equal importance customer as same as that of the saving current. Okay, so I can add insurance cover on this also, personal accident cover on this term deposit also. So it is all of the above. Okay. 24/7. We are in the Achiever series for RBWM. Here we are covering all the important theory, numericals, objective questions, case studies. So follow the video till the end. Also follow the complete series available in the playlist on Officers@da 24/7. Okay? Click on the bell icon. Subscribe to the channel. Share it with your friends. Share it on all your social media platforms. So let's start. Among the below mentioned statements, which of the following are not correctly matched? Not correctly. So understand the question. Whether you want a true or false, that's important. So here you want false. First, keep it in your mind what you have to do. True or false. So you want a false one. Okay. The first stage of product life cycle is known as intro. Introduction. The final stage of product life cycle is known as decline. Predominantly horizontally organized model is mostly product oriented with a common customer database information for some of the products. The design for designing retail banking products and services, customers can broadly group together based on their need pyramids, and this is false. Now look at true and false also. So introduction, first stage. Last stage, decline. Predominantly horizontally, that is false. Okay, and this designing retail by products and services, so they can be grouped as per the need pyramid, false. So which of them is not correct? Okay, so the first stage is introduction. Let's see one by one. This is introduction. What is the PLC, product life cycle? It's like this, right? This is your PLC, product life cycle. This is introduction. This is growth, okay. This is maturity, and last one is decline, okay. So First two are correct. Look at this. Introduction. Done. So this is true. The final stage is decline. See this decline over here. This is true. So both are true. Now these two only. Predominantly horizontally organized model is mostly product oriented with common customer information for some products. Some. Okay. So remember this. Predominantly horizontally organized means some data is shared among all the products. And product oriented means the data is shared within the same product, but not within other products. So this is true. This answer is true, but what is given? It's given as false. So this is not correctly matched. So this is your answer. See, it is not correctly matched. Okay. The important part over here is, look at this. In this PH, there are basically four models. One is horizontal model, second is vertical model, third is PH, predominantly horizontal model, and third PV, predominantly vertical model. Okay. So under PH, some data is shared, some. Under PV, most of the data is shared. Under vertical, complete data is shared. So that is the best model. Vertical model is one of the best models. And what about this last one? For designing retail banking products and services, customers can be grouped together based on their pyramids, on their need pyramids, right? So for designing retail banking products and services, customers can be grouped based on their need pyramids. So which of them is not correctly matched? This should be true. Okay, this is true. They are matched on this or based on their need pyramids. So that is also true. So the answer will be D also. So E option should be there, both C and D. Okay. So both will be correct over here. So C and D. D is also correct. In exam, if they give you, they'll give you these both the options, C and D, and some option will be there, both. Because what is the need pyramid? Need pyramid means that refers to the Maslow's hierarchy, physiological, safety, social. I've taken this many times, isn't it? Esteem, and last one is that actualization. So they are grouped, customers are grouped as per this, groups, okay? Need pyramids or physiological levels. Got it? Among the below given statements, which of the following is not correct in context to the impact of deregulation and Regal-Neal Act of 1994, Graham-Leach-Lilly Act of 1999? Very difficult. I don't think so. This will be asked to you in question, but in exam. But then also, you want false one. Okay. I don't think this will, such questions are asked, because I have not seen many questions like this. But even, let's see. If your luck is hard, you can be asked anything. Okay. Basically, this is not related to our country. This is related to US. Okay. So what is that? Let's read the options. It allowed banks to branch and merge across the state lines. It contributed banks consolidation that focused on reducing cost to boost profits. The Regal-Neal Act of 1994 allowed branches to distribute insurance and securities products. Declining number of banks and rising number of branches have resulted in greater consolidation of branches and deposits in the nation's larger banks. So which of them is false you wanted? False. Sure, don't think that much on this. I'll just give the answer. If such question comes, remember, it is answer is C. This is false. Remaining all are true. Remember, they are not related to our country, Bharat. They are related to USA. So some typical point is mentioned in the book regarding this. But generally, they are not asking this. But if your luck is hard, you will be asked. So in that case, what do? You first study all the true ones also. This is true. This is true. So it allowed banks to merge and banks to branch and merge. Branch means increase the branches or reduce the branches. It contributed to the bank consolidation that focused on reducing cost to boost profits. And last one, true, is this declining number. The declining number of banks and rising number of branches have resulted in greater consolidation of branches and deposits in the nation's larger banks. Okay. So these are all true and you want the false one. So false one is given, but you also read the true ones. Okay. Among the below given statements, which are the following reasons responsible for emergence of retail banking business in India? Emergence. Okay, so now you want true ones. Which of them are true? Socioeconomic fundamentals, growing urban population, higher disposable incomes, and all of the above. Quite obvious, isn't it? Answer is quite obvious over here. The answer is correct. D. All of the above. Here, strong economic fundamentals, growing urban population, higher disposable income, rising young population, right? Rising mass affluent space. Mass affluent means those who are having this middle income but are in large numbers. Emergence of new customer segments. Explosion of service economy in our country. Opportunities across geographies and customer segments. Now see, the important part about this across geographies means earlier banking and money was concentrated in the city areas. Now it has reached to the village areas also. So across geographies, huge untapped potential for retail banking because of the Jan Dhan account. All the bank accounts, all of them have come under the banking finance schemes now or inclusion now. Okay. In India, whereas till recently retail banking was confined to this top and middle level customers, right? As I told in the city. Nowadays things have changed. Nowadays it has gone to the village level also. NBFCs are working very hard nowadays with respect to the banks. They focus on the bottom of the pyramid, lower level. They always focus. Because of this, what happened? Because of this NBFC, the best thing is the Saukari system. Even in today villages, Saukari system is there. Even in today, even why in villages, even cities, it's there. So this Jan Dhan account system or Jan Dhan loan scheme, that Mudra loan, everything, those were truly game changing. They have almost removed the Saukari system, almost, and they are still to grow. They still will be growing a lot. Okay. So coming back, all of the above is the answer for emergence of retail banking. Now, retail banking does not only include accounts. Many of us feel that retail banking means CASA, Jan Dhan accounts. No. It also relates to loans. It also relates to insurance. Retail, smaller insurance. Anything which affects the common person living in the downtrodden region will be called as the retail banking. Okay. Among the following, which of the following stages there is more growth and sales volume peak? More growth, sales volume will peak. Introduction, growth, maturity, and saturation means this is a decline stage. Decline. Okay, these are the four stages actually. Decline. So PLC, as I showed you just now in the first question, this is a PLC, right? Here what happens? Now look at this. This is a sales graph. This is sales versus this is time. Okay, sales versus time. Here sales is almost zero in introduction phase. In growth it goes on increasing, and in maturity it's a maximum maturity, and decline it goes down. Now if you are a business owner, what will you try to do? Where should your company be? Type in the comment section. If you are the business owner, where should your company be? It should be in the introduction phase, growth phase, maturity phase, or decline phase as the owner of the company. Many of you are typing, you should be in the growth phase. This phase you are typing, but this answer is wrong. You should not be in the growth phase. You should be in this maturity phase. Why? Because you want the maximum sales. Where is the maximum sales? Maximum sales is in the maturity phase. So you'll try to keep your company in the maturity phase. When your product matures, remember, it is sure to go on the declining stage. So what do? You add additional features to this product and new PLC starts. Always remember, new features are added. Alto with the changed features. Alto car, right? It went down. Maruti. Maruti is very good in this maturity phase dealing. They always add new features and increase the life cycle of that product. Got it? So, sales volume peak is maturity phase. Okay? If you look at the profit graph for this will be like this. Okay? Profit graph will be like this. It will go down first, then it will go start growing over here, and then it will grow like this, and then like this. So profit will be first negative and sales will start from zero. That is the difference. Okay, move on. Among the following, in which of the given stages the product becomes less attractive for the consumers due to various reasons and results in drop in the sales volume? Introduction, growth, maturity and decline. Now you know this answer is right, decline phase. So what should you do? This is a stage, this is your decline phase, right? So here you should adding the features, new features to this product, so that it doesn't go in this decline stage, it moves up from here. We have always should always try to remove this decline phase from our product life cycle. Every owner will try to remove this phase. Every owner will try to stop over here or move out from this with new features. Which product has gone into this decline phase? Do you know? Nokia phones. Nokia, right? Nokia phones. Nokia phones were once at this level, peak level, right? Every phone in our country was Nokia. Every phone, almost. Today, where is Nokia? Gone. Decline. Why? They didn't look at these features, new features coming in. When Nokia was there, Android phones were just coming up at that time, right? 2005 to 2008, Android was coming up. They didn't look into it. They carried on with their own operating system and gone. Same thing happens with banks also, many banks. They don't look into what is the present situation and what does the customer want. Nowadays in banking, customer doesn't want to come to the branch, at least the HNI customer, those who give you the maximum business, they don't want to come to the branch. They want to deal through that internet banking, app banking, phone banking, everything. So that should be made more easy vis-a-vis coming to the branches, isn't it? Of course, personal touch is required, but personal touch is required only, you can do the personal touch only if your other customers are transferred to the alternate channels. Otherwise, you'll just waste your time giving that savings balance, current balance, printing, passbook printing, all these things. Okay? Got it? Next one. Among the following, which of the following account includes value additions like internet banking, mobile banking, tagged insurance cover, personal accident cover, sweep-in, sweep-out facility, other concessions like free remittances, savings, current, term and combination deposits? Which of them will include? What is a combination deposit? Combination deposit is a deposit of, it's called a sweep-in, sweep-out. Okay? Combination of term and the savings. Term and OD actually, not savings, term and OD. Right? So which account will have, among these options, which account will have the value additions like internet banking, mobile banking? You can definitely see this, isn't it? Internet, mobile. I'll add one more option to this. Now let's see. Okay? I'll add one more option. That option is, hold on. Yeah, I'll add one more option. That option is E. That E option is all of the above. So if I add all of the above option over here, then the answer will be right one. Because it will be all of the above over here. See, always remember, I can add these features, internet banking, mobile banking, insurance cover, personal accident cover, sweep in, sweep out, other concessions, free remittance. I can add it to any of the account. Whatever I want, I can add it to savings, current, term, combination. You'll say, how can I add it to term deposit? Yeah, I can add it. Internet banking can be there for FD also. Mobile banking, I can give it for FD also. Am I not a customer of the bank? Any term deposit customer who's having only FD with you is also the equal importance customer as come same as that of the saving current. Okay, so I can add insurance cover on this also, personal accident cover on this term deposit also. So it is all of the above. Okay. Hi friends, welcome to Adda 24/7. We are in the Achiever series for RBW. Here we are covering important theory, numericals, objective questions, case studies. So follow the video till the end. Also, follow the complete series, like the video. Share it with your friends on all your social media platforms. Subscribe to the channel Officers Adda 24/7 YouTube channel. Okay, click on the bell icon. Let's start. Among the following, in which of the following account interest rate depends upon the period of interest, and these are offered with the facility of getting monthly, quarterly interest as well as deposits with the cumulative interest at the end of the deposit period: saving, current, term and combination deposit. Very basic question, right? Which of them is offered with the facility of monthly, quarterly or half yearly or yearly or cumulative? Simple one, isn't it? Term deposit. The answer is okay. Term deposit. Now, for those who are new in banking, many of the bankers are new, or many of them are not, have not joined the banking. They are giving the JIB without this DBF, right? Diploma in Banking and Finance. For those guys, the explanation. Because many students are there who are not the bankers. What are term deposits? Term deposits are held for a definite period. Interest rate depends on the period of interest, and these are offered with the facility of getting this monthly, quarterly, half yearly, anything. Okay, cumulative also. One variant of this term deposit is, remember, recurring deposit. Recurring is same as term deposit. Only recurring means you have to pay in installments and you get the money at the end. The rate of interest applicable is same of FD rate. Okay. Now the advantage of recurring deposit is the term deposit interest rate for specified period are offered to this deposit. That's the advantage, and it helps you to pay in installments. That's the main advantage. Okay. Now what are combination deposits? Look at this. Combination deposits means FD plus savings. That is called a sweep in, sweep out. Okay. So these are combination deposits. Current means what? These are for businesses. Those who want to run businesses, they have to open the current account. Savings is for the personal level. For you and me, we open the savings account. Got it? Among the below given, which of the following gives benefit of both term deposit as well as saving or current deposit? So say term plus saving and current. So it's a combination of term plus saving current. Okay. Saving or current, anything. So you can combine them. Which is this? Saving deposit, current deposit, term deposit and combination deposit. Which of them will be the answer over here? It is correct. Combination. See here, what is this combination deposit? What is combination deposit? See here, as I told you earlier, it's a combination of saving and current. Sweep in, sweep out, we call it. So what do you mean by this sweep in, sweep out? See this. Always remember sweep. This is called a sweep account. Sweep means, suppose, see, I'm having an FD. FD of, let's say, 2 lakh with you. 2 lakh FD. Okay. Now, what happens? I'm having a savings account with you. Savings account. Now the balance in the savings account is, let's say, 10,000. Okay. Savings is the balance. Now what do? I give a check. Okay. Of, let's say, 20,000. So check is of 20,000 now. 20,000. So what happens now? This check comes for clearing. Clearing means for debiting my account. But I don't have balance in this account. So if I have this sweep in facility, sweep in, I link this FD to this savings link. Okay. So what happens whenever this check comes for clearing 20,000, this FD is broken and the money is transferred to the savings account. So in this case, what happens? The amount becomes more than 20,000 and the check is passed. So this is called a sweep in. Okay. Similarly, we have sweep out facility, sweep out. Okay. It's a reverse one. Suppose if I am having the savings account, savings, and I constantly am having 10,000 rupees in that account, constant. Okay. Constant means not 10,000, let's say 1 lakh. 1 lakh rupees constant in your account. Now, how much am I earning on this? 3.5% means savings account balance 3.5, right? Interest. So bank offers me a facility of converting the remaining amount into FD. Means I'll make an agreement with the bank that keep 10,000 in that account, 10,000 keep it in the account, keep constantly, okay, in SB, savings bank account, okay. And after 10,000, whatever the remaining amount, kindly transfer it to FD. FD. Okay, so this remaining amount, see, today it's 1 lakh, sometimes it might be 80,000. So whatever is above 10,000, kindly transfer it to FD. Okay, so this is known as sweep out. So what is the advantage? I don't have to make separate FDs, they get automatically transferred. Okay, so this is sweep in and sweep out. Next. Banking facilities like collection of checks, safe deposit lockers, standing instructions for carrying out instructions of the customer on periodic basis, merchant banking services in area of capital market, market issue management in the capacity as a lead manager, co-manager to the issues, etc. comes under which category? Savings, current, term and other services. Means what are you say? What are you looking at this? Look at it. Collection of checks, safe deposit lockers, standing instructions, merchant banking, all these will come under which category? Look at the options. It'll be other services. Okay, other services. Now let me explain you something about other services. All the services which are given by the banks other than deposit and loans are known as other. These are also called as ancillary services. Okay, so they can further be classified. These other services can be classified into remittance and other fee based. Remittance means what? Remittance means all this: checks, clearing, issue of drafts, clearing services, bankers checks, NEFT, RTGS, even this UPI now. So all these are other services. These are for this remittances. And what are fee based? Fee based means basically you are talking of insurance, mutual fund, issuance of LCs. These are also fee based. Even lockers are also fee based. Okay, standing instructions, there also we charge the customer for that standing instruction. Okay, merchant banking, these are all fee based. So basically we are talking of other services over here. Okay, what are other services? There are two types of other services, remember. Okay, one is, what are the other two types? One is remittance, means money transfer. Okay, just to summarize, and second is others, means fee based. Okay, got it. Non-fund based business of banks is a part of other services. This includes which of the following? Now, non-fund based: letter of guarantee, letter of credit, both A and B, none of the above. So just now I showed you this other services. One is remittance, second is fee based. So this becomes a part of fee based. Fee. So fee based, and that also other services. So which is it? See this, LC, letter of guarantee we issue it, letter of credit we issue it. So answer will be both A and B. Okay, understand the difference between LC and guarantee. There is a slight difference. Okay, many a times we feel or we call them as one only, but these two are different. Okay, LC and guarantee are totally different. See this, guarantee is a secondary method of payment. Guarantee means guarantee. Okay, guarantee and LC. Guarantee is a secondary method of payment. Secondary method means, what do you mean by secondary method? If the buyer doesn't pay, then the bank will pay. And LC is a primary method of payment. Primary method. Okay. So LC is a primary method of payment. Guarantee is a secondary method of payment. Got it? In guarantee, bank will pay only if the buyer or the party of the bank will not pay. In LC, the other party of the bank is not concerned. LC, bank will have to pay. Of course, bank will take it from that customer only. But it is a primary mode of payment. So that's why you must remember this secondary and primary very clearly. Okay. Next. Among the following, which one is correctly matched on the basis of definition of the risk management? Risk management means where, what do you mean by risk management? A risk is where the risk is more, where the risk is less, in which product the risk is more. Okay, so let's read them. Risk management is an integrated process of delineating specific areas of risk, developing comprehensive plan, integrating the plan, conducting an ongoing evaluation. So that is the definition of risk management from Oxford. Risk management is a process of measuring and assessing risk and then developing strategies to manage the risk. So that is one second definition. Managing the risk can involve taking out insurance against a loss, hedging a loan against the interest rate risk, and protecting an investment against fall in the interest rate. So this is another definition. So which one of them is correctly matched? See, this correctly matched means who gave it correct. Now see, our definitions are all correct, but only problem is who gave it correct. Is this of the Oxford? Is this of Wikipedia? Is this of Dr. P.K. Gupta? So that is the question. Which one is correctly matched? Have you read the books? In there, it's all given. So the correctly matched answer is B. Okay, B. Okay, let's study then what is the correct answer for others. Dr. P.K. Gupta. Okay, risk management is an integrated process of delineating specific areas, developing comprehensive plan, integrating the plan, and conducting the ongoing evaluation. So the definition which is given of Oxford is actually this. No, P.K. Gupta is correct. Okay, so whatever is said in P.K. Gupta's definition is correct. Now let's look at Wikipedia's definition. Risk management is the process of measuring or assessing risk and then developing strategies to manage the risk. So managing the risk can involve taking out insurance against the loss. Okay, so this taking out insurance against the loss, this is the definition of Oxford actually. Okay, so this definition, say this against this, yeah, protecting, taking out insurance, this definition is actually of Oxford. Okay, and this P.K. Gupta's definition is over here. This is P.K. Gupta. So it's reverse one. Okay. Got it? So only true one was this. Risk management is the process of assessing risk, then developing strategies to manage the risk. Okay. Next. So got it? See, I think I said wrongly earlier, isn't it? So correct answer is only B, that is Wikipedia. This definition is correct and remaining ones are reverse one. What is given for Oxford is actually P.K. Gupta. What's given for P.K. Gupta is actually Oxford. Okay, got it everyone? Next. Among the below mentioned methods, which of the following are not the methods of risk identification? Not, okay. Bowtie analysis, what if technique, then fault tree analysis and SWOT analysis, not the methods of risk identification. The answer is not. Not is SWOT. SWOT is not the answer. Okay, not the method of risk identification. SWOT is what? Strength, weakness, opportunities, and threat. It does not give you about risk. It talks about your overall standing actually. Okay, risk identification actually provides the foundation of risk management. The identification methods formed by the template or development of templates for identifying the source or this problem event, these are basically the identification methods. So various methods are what? This brainstorming analysis, then interview checklist, what if technique, okay, fault tree, all these are the methods. But SWOT analysis is not the method of this risk analysis. Okay. Dash implies that the losses arising due to risk exposure shall be retained and assumed by the party or the organization. So dash implies losses arising due to the risk exposure retained by the party or the organization. So who says that if the risk will be retained by the party or that organization, whichever that customer is? Firstly, what is risk retention? Retained means what? What do you mean by retention? Risk retention implies that the losses arising due to risk exposure. Okay, means basically this. Retention means, suppose if I have to pay something, okay, on happening of certain event. So if that event happens, then I have to pay. So it becomes my duty. So the risk lies with me. That is basically retention. Transfer, avoidance, these are totally different aspects, and this potential risk treatments. So these three are different aspects altogether. The correct one is over here, risk retention. It says that the party who has taken this will be taken the risk will be the first one to pay. Okay, means first one to give this to make the payment basically. Okay, there are two things over here. One is self-insurance and captive insurance. Now, these are the two methods of retention. Self-insurance and captive insurance. So what is captive insurance? Captive insurance is basically defined as an insurance company that is wholly owned and controlled by the insured. And its primary purpose is to insure the risk of its owners. Its insured benefits from the captive insurance underwriting profits. Okay, so that is captive, and self means exactly opposite, wholly owned and controlled by the insured. Okay, that is captive, but this is not wholly owned or controlled by the insured. That is self insurance. So the answer over here is risk retention strategy. Dash is a risk management technique that involves dispersing key assets. This ensures that if something catastrophic occurs at one location, the impact of the business is limited to the assets only at that location. Very important one. Yeah. Only to that location. So answer is simple. Look at the options. Avoidance, loss prevention, loss reduction, and separation. What can be the answer? It is separation. Okay, separation means you divide this unit into different parts. This is my company. Okay, so I'll divide it into separate parts. So if some loss occurs over here, it will be confined to this part only. It won't spread to other parts. So it won't spread. Okay, so it will be confined to only that location. That is basically separation. Okay, these are the various techniques. See, this separation is there. There are other avoidance, loss prevention, loss reduction. I have taken this separately as a topic. Okay, so D is the answer. Okay, hi friends, welcome to the Achiever series of RBW. Here we are covering all the numericals, objective questions, case studies. So remember, case studies are asked nowadays in JIB. Earlier they were not asked, but nowadays they are being asked. So follow the series complete, share it with your friends, share it on all your social media platforms. Okay, so let's start immediately without wasting the time. First one, Dash is the risk management technique that essentially involves the creation of a backup plan. Backup plan. Now, what is the risk management technique that involves the creation of a backup plan? Very important question. Now, there are various risk management techniques. Okay. Out of them, which one is the one which creates the backup plan? Think over it. So the answer is, okay, let me mark it. The answer is C, okay? Duplication. Duplication is a backup plan. Earlier I have covered avoidance also, okay? So today we are covering this duplication. Backup plan means duplication. Got it? So duplication is a risk management technique that essentially involves the creation of a backup plan. This is often necessary with the technology, means here, for technology it's always necessary, right? A failure with an information system server should not bring the whole business to the halt, isn't it? Server gone, everything gone. If this happens today, then what? Now look at the problem with our banking system today. It's all dependent on the server. So instead of backup or failover, server should be really available for access in the event that the prime server fails. So we should have a backup server. Another example of duplication as a risk management technique is when a company makes use of disaster recovery service. Okay, disaster recovery means we call it BCP, business continuity plan. Okay, so that's why C is the answer, duplication. Got it? Next one, quite big one. Dash is a risk that you lock into is the risk that the value of your high yielding fixed deposits or corporate deposits, let me expand this, okay, that the value of your high fixed deposits or corporate deposits at the highest available rate, that is currently let's say 9.5, and when your interest payment comes in, there is no equivalent higher interest rate investment avenue available for you to reinvest in these interest proceeds. For example, if your interest is paid out after 1 year, the prevailing interest rate is 8% at that time. Now, firstly, you understand the problem over here. What is the problem? The problem over here is, will I be getting the same rate of interest if I go to invest whatever I've invested now in on a future date? Let's say I'm having an FD now. Okay. That FD is for, let's say, 2 years. Now, the real question, and the rate of interest of that FD is, let's say, 9.5%. So the real question is, after 2 years, when I go for this reinvestment, means I'll take that FD out and again reinvest it. So will I be getting the same rate of interest, 9.5, or will I be getting some lower rate of interest like 8% at that time? So this risk is known as what? Country risk, credit risk, reinvestment risk, and political risk. Yeah, it is known as what? Country. See, the answer is seemingly simple, isn't it? You might have gone by now. Everyone might have got by now, right? So the answer is what? What is the option in the comment section? Let me see in the comment section. The answer is correct. Reinvestment risk, isn't it? Now, what is the reinvestment risk? You know, reinvestment means, already I've told you that after 2 years, will I be getting the same rate of interest? But theoretically, what is the definition? Let's see. So this reinvestment risk is a risk that you lock into high yielding FDs or corporate deposits. Lock into means you book those FDs at current rate, that is whatever 9.5, whatever it is, okay? When your interest rate payment comes, there is no equivalent high interest amount, right? That's what is given in the question, so that you can lock it again. So currently, as we are at a interest rate peak, it would be advisable to lock in for a longer tenure. Now, what is the method of solving this problem? Here, problem you got it that after 2 years I may not get the same rate of FD. So what should I do in this case? For such cases, what we should do is, we must try to book the longer term FD whenever we are having the high rate of interest. Right now the rate of interest is at the peak, let's say 9.5, right? Highest available. So what will I do? I'll take the advantage of this. I'll book the FD for next 5 years, not 2 years, so that I can definitely take the advantage of this higher rate of interest. That should be the strategy followed, isn't it? So we must book the FD for the longer tenure to avoid the financing reinvestment risk, right? Hence the option is C is correct, reinvestment. Dash applies to any financial instrument that are denoted in the currency other than your own. Other than means, suppose if I am having this in my rupees, see, firstly understand this. Other than your own means what? Financial instruments. Now there can be two FDs. Okay, one FD is a resident FD, means normal FD. Resident we call it, resident, right? Resident FD. So this is your normal FD. Second is FCNR. What is FCNR? Foreign currency, right? FCNR, non-resident. That actually it's called as FCNRB. Okay. So this is in either dollar or euro or any currency, but not rupees. So this is known as this. The problem is related to this FCNR. Financial instruments that are denoted in the currency other than your own. So which risk is applied over here? Country, credit, reinvestment, or forex, foreign exchange? So the answer is obviously again D. But what is foreign exchange risk? Now answers are simple. You might be able to write this, but you need to understand the risk. What is that risk? Foreign exchange risk means what? Forex risk applies to any financial instrument that is denoted in other currency. Simple. For example, if a UK firm means England, I won't call it UK now because what is UK? I don't say UK. It should be Britain. Okay? It should be simple Britain. If a Britain firm or London firm has invested in India and an Indian investment does well in rupee terms, the firm might still lose money because the rupee has depreciated against the pound. Means they have invested some, let's say, 1 lakh pounds, because other currency means Britain means pounds. They have invested 1 lakh pounds and tomorrow, let's say, they get a good return. They get a return of around 9%. So 1 lakh plus 9%. So 1 lakh 9%, 9,000 pounds. But the problem is, if rupee grows well and this pound depreciates, goes down, then the firm will face a problem of forex. Okay, so if the rupee has depreciated again, UK firm still lose money if rupee has depreciated against the pound. So when the firm decides to pull out its investment on maturity, it gets fewer pounds on redemption, fewer pounds, right? So if rupee has depreciated means pound has appreciated. In that case, for this company will lose on the forex. With the recent very sharp fall in the rupee, the forex risk of our country as an investment destination has greatly increased. And the option D is a right choice. Got it? Move on. Next one. Dash is a risk that the value of your investment will fall due to the market risk factors, which include equity risk. What is equity risk? Risk that the stock market prices or volatility is changing. So that is basically equity risk. Or which includes interest rate risk. What is interest rate risk? Means rate of interest fluctuations. And because of this, what happens? Rate of interest fluctuation, the bond prices go down or up. Okay. Third is currency risk. Risk of the currency fluctuation means dollar goes up or dollar goes down. Right now, what is the rate of dollar right now? Everyone, what is the rate of dollar? Type in the comment section. Let me see. Okay. So currency risk, rate of the currency fluctuations, or commodity risk. Risk of fluctuations in the commodity prices. What is commodity? Commodity can be anything, gold, okay, or this oil. These are all the main commodities. So which is the risk? Market risk, inflationary risk, reinvestment risk, and forex risk. Which is the right answer over here? Let me see in the comment section. Which is the right answer? So the answer is market risk. Okay, market risk. Now what is market risk? Sir, market risk means basically fluctuations due to the factors which are not in your hands, right? This way, this is a risk that your value of your investment or your assets will go up or down. So it includes all these four. what equity, just now as I told you, equity, interest rate, currency and commodity. There are other types of risk too. What are the other types of risk? Such as legislative, legal risk, global risk, timing risk and more. But for the scope of this total discussion, what we'll do is we'll only focus on the market risk, because market risk is not in your hands. Always remember, market risk is a risk which is not in your hands. So all these things, look at this currency, commodity, oil prices go up or down, is it in your hands? No. Dollar goes up or down, is it in your hands? No. Stock prices go up or down, is it in your hands? No. So that is known as market risk. Whatever is not in your hands is known as a market risk. Okay, whatever is not in your hands. What are the other risks then? If this is market risk, what are the other risks? Other risks are, see, there are basically three risks: credit, market and ops, operations. Okay, ops. These are the three risks. Okay, among the below, which of the following doesn't come under the category of direct taxes? Income tax, expenditure tax, securities transaction tax and customs duty and octroi. Which of them does not come under this direct taxes? Firstly, what are the types of taxes? The types of taxes are basically direct and indirect. There are two types of taxes. One is direct and second one is indirect. What is the difference? Direct and indirect. See, direct tax means that tax which we pay. Fill the form and pay. Fill the form and pay. Okay, means income tax. How do you pay the income tax? You pay the fill the income tax form. Okay, that challan 280, 281, all these, right? That is direct. Indirect means which you do not fill the form, but you pay. For example, GST. GST everyone pays, but we don't fill that form, right? So income tax, expenditure tax, security transaction tax and this customs duty and octroi, which one doesn't come under the category? What is the answer? Answer is customs duty and octroi. Okay, customs duty and octroi. It doesn't come under the category of direct taxes. See, direct tax means what? Income tax, expenditure tax, etc., securities transaction. Okay, perquisite tax. This is also one more. Perquisite tax, gift tax. These are all direct taxes. Indirect means what? VAT. Nowadays, VAT is gone. GST. But still, VAT is there. Remember, VAT is not gone. Remember, VAT is existing on, I think so, petrol. Petrol still, it's existing. GST, it doesn't come under the GST category. Okay. So VAT, GST, excise, customs duty, octroi, these are all indirect taxes. Okay. Hence the answer is D. Got it? Move on. Next one. Understood up till now? Clear? Move on. Among the below given, match which of the following is correctly matched. Now you want correctly matched. So first is saving current. Bank will inform of any change in the minimum balance to be maintained 30 days in advance. Means, suppose if I change my MAB, okay, then in before how many days should I inform the client? Let's see, my MAB has changed. If you want, you can change the bank. My MAB has changed. So should I inform the client 30 days in advance? You have to think. I'll give you the answer later. Dormant or inoperative accounts. Customer will also be informed 1 month before the customer's account is classified as dormant or inoperative. Means, so whenever I classify the account as dormant or inoperative, right word is inoperative now. Okay. So I'll have to inform the client 1 month before. Is it true or false? That you'll have to check. Closing customer's account. Bank will exchange soiled, mutilated notes and small coins at its branches as per the RBI directives. What is this? Closing customer's account and this. Okay, so is this correct? Next one, cash transactions. Under the normal circumstances, bank will not close the customer's account without giving the customer at least 30 days notice. I think so this should be over above. Okay, so let me change it. Give me 1 minute. Okay, I'll change this because this has been brought down. This has to go up. Okay, hold on. Because it is wrongly printed over here. It should go down. And this should go up. Got it? Now okay? Look at this. So closing customer's account, under normal circumstances, bank will not close a customer's account without giving a notice of 30 days. Cash transactions, bank will exchange soil mutilated notes and small coins at its branches as per the RBI directives. Now what do you want? Which of the following is correctly matched? Correctly. Okay? Now you think over it. What is the answer? Correctly matched. The answer is, everyone, let me see in the comment section. The answer is A, savings. Okay, bank will inform about a change in the MAB at least 30 days in advance. This is correctly matched. Remaining all are wrong. Why? Let's see. See this. First one already I have told you correctly matched. Okay, so the minimum balance to be maintained in the savings account will be displayed at the branches. Bank will inform of any change in the minimum balance 30 days in advance. Now what about the dormant accounts? In advance, in a dormant or inoperative accounts, customer will be informed 3 months. 3 months, remember, inoperative accounts, 3 months before the customer's account is classified as inoperative. Okay. Bank will not charge the customer for activation of the inoperative account. Very important point. Bank should never charge the customer for activation of the inoperative account. Some banks do charge, but that is wrong. Okay. Next, closing the customer's account. So bank will have to give the notice of how many days? What is given over here in the question? We want correctly matched. Bank will not close the account without giving the customer a notice of at least 30 days notice. Okay. So this will be one sec. I'll just remove this not because bank will close the customer's account without giving the notice of at least 30 days. So this is wrong. Bank will not close the account. Okay. Bank will not close the account. That is the right answer. That's why A is correct. And cash transactions, bank will exchange soil mutilated notes or small coins at the branches as per RBI directives. Okay. So which of the following is correctly matched? Okay. But what are the options? Let me see. So the option over here is, see this, A is correct. Then D is correct. Even I'll check this, make this C also correct. One sec, eraser. So even this C is correct over here. Okay, C is also correct. So if the question comes in exam, it is A, C and D, all the three are correct. So you'll be given the options in the exam, like A option will be, which one is correct? A, C, D. B option will be something A, B, C, D, all of them. Right, then something all anything. Okay, so the you must get the logic correct. Savings current 30 days in advance, customer's account closed 30 days in advance, cash transactions, this bank will exchange the soil, small coins and mutilated notes. Okay, and dormant account, it should be 3 months. Okay, it's not 1 month, it should be 3 months. Okay, got it? Okay with this, everyone? So the final answer is A, C and D, all are correct, all the three are correct, A, C and D, it's B is not correct, got it? Let me mark this again, I've just cleaned the screen. Okay, now before going, I would suggest everyone join the revision batch, power packed revision batch for JIB. All the numericals, objective questions, case study just now started, it's all are covered, all the subjects are covered. Join immediately, and if you join it now, you are getting triple benefit. Triple benefit, biggest price drop, 80% discount and double X validity. how to get this? Let me show you. Go to ADDA 24/7. See this. Go to ADDA 24/7 over here. Click on JIB and CIB. Always go through the app. In the app, what happens? You get 1% extra. So always go through the app. So click on JIB and CIB to get this. Click on JIB May 24. You'll see the revision batches. Okay, power packed revision batches. Click on this batch. You'll see ebooks, test series, online live classes, doubt solving, counseling, experienced faculties, live and recorded sessions. Everything you are getting. Okay, and at what cost? Just click on the discount offer. Put the code Y432. See this. Y432 will give you maximum discount anytime. So it is 79% plus one on the app using that coin systems. So 80% off. Also, if you join Mahapack, you will see this double validity. Means what? You buy for 6 months, you get it for 12 months. You buy for 12 months, you get it for 24 months. Such huge discounts. Okay. So don't miss the offer and don't forget the code Y432.